Who would have imagined if I was to show you a picture from Sweden that of a spring evening, people would be dancing tango? This is actually in Malmo, one of the most known industrial towns in Sweden. And this is just showing that cultures change. And if you make the right environment, people actually might start dancing. Now, I was given this this thing about 10 commandments, and that sounded really, really preachy and like some foreigner coming and telling us what to do. But it was really, really great to be in Sydney, and ever since I was a little boy, sounds like I grew up in the 50s or something, but I remember we had this colored calendar with a picture of the Sydney Opera House. And I remember my mum telling me, oh, it's this really special building and it took a long time to build. And I guess part of me becoming an architect was this dream of coming to Sydney and seeing this opera house. And every time I come to Sydney, I make a pilgrimage to go and kind of like kiss the tiles and worship the great god of design, Utzon. And I walked through the Botanic Gardens this year, and being an urban designer, I noticed nice human scale bench. And then I thought it was really nice, there was a little plaque. And there was this little invitation, rest a while, enjoy the view. And I thought, actually, it's not about commandments. I think what we really have to talk about is invitations. We can't force anybody to do anything. But if we invite people to enjoy the view, to sit, enjoy their city, that's a good starting point. Rest a while, and it's really fantastic. I really recommend, if you've got a Sunday afternoon, take a tour, you know, in the Botanic Gardens and just see some of these little poetic messages. And what's fantastic, if you look at all of these little messages, they're about love and they're about life. And it just makes you feel so optimistic about human nature. And this is a really lovely little kind of invitation. And see, there's loads of them, you know, all about love and life. You know, just, you know, I don't know who Sonia and Franco are, but you can imagine their stories. And I guess urban designers were very interested in making livable cities. And you don't have to be Japanese to kind of know what this message is about. And I guess for a long time, we've known about how we use space in the cities. And if you take away the cars, you can get so much space left over for maybe doing other stuff. And I guess, I mean, you can see by the clothes, these are old photographs. So we've known this for a long time. But I guess it's also about making lovable cities, cities that we really care about, cities that live, that have soul. You know, and you always say you measure what you care about. And so much of cities, they measure traffic flow and square meterage and all of this kind of soulless stuff. And I guess the story of our office about Gale Architects, about Jan Gale, started with this kind of soulless stuff in the 1960s in Scandinavia. And Jan Gale kind of was interested in this idea of the life between the buildings. Because even if we design these optimally designed new dwellings with functional kitchens and hot and cold water, there was something about all this space, and even this just grass just didn't inspire people to live there. And actually, it's a love story, because Jan Gale met an environmental psychologist called Ingrid, and each of them researched this subject of the human environment and how we behave. And so you can see it's love between the buildings too. And what's going on? And it's a lot of architecture stuff is about opinion. Like, I like this, I don't like this, and art and stuff. But there's some really basic stuff about human beings, about human behavior, which is kind of more to do with biology and psychology. So there are kind of facts. We start with people, and cultures are different. And you're going to say, well, you're coming here from, you know, from Copenhagen. We're not Scandinavians here. You know, we're not going to do this public life stuff, you know, and you just need to get the plane from Melbourne to know that cities are different, cultures are different. Living in Scandinavia, we're very aware of climate. We have a very different summer, winter situation. So climate plays a huge role in how we behave. But basically, what we've discovered from research and working around the world, that basically we all function more or less the same way. How we use space, how we enjoy space, how we relate to other people is kind of universal. So the first invitation of these invitations rather than commandments is an invitation to walk. And then you have to really to understand human beings. You have to think about, we're the walking animal. This is what makes us different from all of the other creatures on the planet. What happened in evolution was we suddenly got up, on our back legs, managed to balance, free up two hands, and we became hunter-gatherers because we could like throw stones, you know, we could carry our bait home, you know, we could do all these things because we moved around on two legs. And that changed the way we experienced the world. And I guess the most important day in your life is probably the day when you stand up on your back legs and start walking. And this is actually my godson. And it was one of those like really amazing moments just to be there. I had my phone, I was taking pictures of him because he's kind of cute. And suddenly he started walking and his dad started crying, you know, like calling his wife, he's walking. And what happened was, and you can see this, Aris, who was just 13 months, saw a puppy. Yeah. And he got so excited about the puppy that he forgot that he couldn't walk. And basically, he's just starting his life as a hunter-gatherer. Slow, curious, sensitive, looking for opportunities. And that's what we do as human beings. We wander the planet looking for opportunities. You know, and now, okay, Aris is now six, so he's more interested than cars, than puppies. Soon it will be girls. And then I guess at some point he'll go back to cars. But the thing about walking animals is we experience things walking. And first of all, like the floor is hugely important, the ground. If you go to really great cities like Venice, the floor of the city is fantastic. That's why in the history of architecture and design, mosaic and marble and parquet floors and Persian carpets are important because you experience so much of the floor. But also we use our senses. And I think architects and designers maybe risk concentrating on the visual aspect and forget that you actually smell a place, you touch a place, you hear a place. So you have to think about places in all with all of those kind of different senses. And the way that we're able to work around the world is because we all kind of more or less come in the same package, like eyes facing forward, nose, ears, hands. No, we're all, I mean, okay, I'm Scottish, so, I mean, in my family, I was really tall. A school friend here will confirm that. And it was that I moved to Sweden and I suddenly became really short. But basically, we're all kind of in the same package, and the way we experience the world is more or less the same. Now, shopkeepers and salespeople, merchants, are the people who best understand human nature. And there's no market in the world where they don't lift the produce to be closer to your face. So you can smell the tomatoes, so you can touch the oranges. And it's really giving you a sensual experience and sensual, you know, using the senses. And as you walk down an old street, you also get these shop fronts, which are full of like decoration and this kind of vertical rhythm and all of this sensual stuff to kind of attract your attention, to seduce you as you walk past, to make you walk slower, to take your time. You know, maybe you'll find those shoes or that bag, you know, just it's a way of seducing you as you walk down the street. And if you notice, it's the first 3 meters of the buildings that are decorated. Above really plain buildings, because it's not worth spending any money there, because human beings, we're down here at eye level. What we experience on the ground, first 3 meters, you know this if you've seen a Robin Hood film. You know, how does Robin Hood hide from the Sheriff of Nottingham? He climbs a tree. In every single Robin Hood film, Sheriff Forrest, up the tree, and you've also got that classic scene. And of course, the Sheriff of Nottingham never looks up, because none of us ever do. Other streets don't seduce us. Now, this is one of the most famous architects in Denmark, really important building. This is Carrera marble, so really expensive material. But this street says, hurry along, go away, don't stay here, don't spend your time. You know you won't find those shoes on the street. You won't find the love of your life. You won't find any puppies here. You know, and these streets are everywhere, even in Sydney. You know, and you know, this girl won't find the love of her life on the street. No, she's, you know, it's really not worth looking at because, you know. And of course, we can do other things. We can really open up the windows, smell the coffee, hear the music, hear the cappuccino machine. And the more of those sensual things you do, the slower we move, the more we enjoy space. Another thing about human beings, apart from the senses, is we're also really sociable. And this is kind of like, what's going on here? A couple of nuns checking out a guy on Piazza Navona. It's kind of interesting. And of course, we're fascinated by social relationships, where, you know, what's going on here? It's kind of kinky, it's interesting. anywhere in the world, you can look at who's watching what on television. You know, the people watching documentaries about town planning, that's a really small group of people. But, you know, soap opera, docu-soap, anything which is about emotion, passion, and people is really interesting. And that's basically because the natural state of human beings is to be with other people. You know, the history of mankind, we've lived in tribes, big families, clans, extended villages. And it's this last second of history that we suddenly live completely alone. You know, that we put babies on their own in rooms and shut the door, let them cry. You know, we sit all day with our computers working on our own. It is completely unnatural. And that is why we are desperate for social contact. And we will happily spend $5, $6, $7 making a cup of coffee, which we could have at home for like 10 cents. But we're buying kind of companionship with our fellow man. And so we can make the city offer invitations to come along to sit. And what really fascinates us with human behavior is this international or this universal behavior. So if you're a student or a fisherman in Denmark, if you're a Greek immigrant in Stockholm, if you live on the street in India, even on the beach in Rio, what you can see in common is everybody knows that when you're with friends, it's really important to be at eye level because your relationship completely changes. And with your friends, you know, you can be, you know, much closer. You know, use the mic. You know, we can talk about, you know, we can talk about the people at the back. You know, the ones that are sleeping or the ones that want to sneak out early. But you know, it's relationships change. And what's interesting, I mean, when it starts off like, okay, I'm like up here, like a politician or a priest or something. But the minute we get to eye level and we get this distance, and the difference between 3 meters, 2 meters. And 1 meter is enormous in terms of what we experience. Yet in planning, nobody ever talks about 3 meters, 2 meters, 1 meter. They talk about, yeah, let's make it 100 meters wider to be sure. You know, it's adding dimension, making things bigger, and we lose this, you know, wonderful, intimate, kind of friendly, eye-level scale, which makes cities enjoyable. And if you get it right, you can invite people to stay. Now, Swiss people playing chess is maybe not the most interesting activity you can think of, but it does give you a legitimate excuse to stop in a public space and watch. And you have a legitimate excuse to start a conversation with another sad old git, you know, and say, oh, he's playing really badly, you know, he's really rubbish. You know, you can start a conversation because there's something to talk about. And we're looking for all these little small street theaters which allow you to kind of engage with your surroundings. And there's this guy, this little boy with his sunglasses on, and he's managed to find a kind of a niche that you can kind of hide in. And just like kind of, I don't know, like an animal in Animal Planet, he's kind of camouflaged and he can watch the street, you know, kind of undisturbed. And it's, you know, and, you know, he feels pretty safe. He's got the wall behind his back, which is something to do with survival. I think it's, you know, you can't be attacked from behind. And you'll know this if you ever go into a restaurant. Nobody ever goes and sits right in the middle. The best seats are that kind of bench thing with a wall. Because, you know, obviously, you're not going to be attacked by another tribe or a bear in a restaurant. But that survival instinct, you know, makes sure you want to have that wall behind you. Anyway, watching life. You know, this invitation to watch what's going on. And this is the best school you can go in. And now, as all of you become students of human behavior, you can start watching like how people behave in public spaces, watching, observing for kids, the best school you can go in. And this continues through life. You know, we're watching different things, but it's the same phenomena. There is nothing as interesting as watching people. You know, and you can see in any, whether you're in Argentina, if you're in Oslo, which is possibly the most expensive cup of coffee you'll ever have, but everybody's doing the same thing, watching people, watching the world go by. And also a really good city, and if you think about those little benches and those plaques in the Botanic Gardens, these encounters with nature, and of course, if you think about the history of humanity, we, you know, came from nature, there's this whole phenomenon of what they call biophilia, enjoying contact with nature. The noise of running water is directly related to survival. You know, running water, good, survival, it sounds good, deep in our inner brain. In Stockholm, they've actively worked in public spaces to make extra swooshy water so it drowns out the noise of traffic, just to make the city a more pleasant space to be. And of course, obviously trees, you know, what a difference it makes. And in this kind of Mexican housing estate, you know, where this wanker of an architect has painted everything orange and purple to make everybody happy, thank God there's a tree. You know, and when you're living in a 23-square-meter apartment with your five children, it's kind of like Valium to go out onto the steps and there's a tree, you hear birds singing, you see the changing season, and, you know, it's cheap to plant trees. But what a huge difference it makes to our environment. And then, you know, we can touch on this whole subject of health, which is a big subject, and actually one of the most exciting projects I have just now is in Scotland. The Minister of Health is looking at taking money from the health budget, the hospital budget, to spend on public space, because there's a direct connection between people's well-being, physical and mental health, and public space. Give it a minute. Think about the irony of this. You know, because it's really funny to laugh at anything in the United States. But the idea of driving to the gym and like taking the escalator, I mean, inside this place, there's a machine which simulates walking, the treadmill. There's a stepper which simulates steps. And there's, you know, there's spinning which simulates riding a bike. And people pay to do this, not only with money, but in their time, rather than being with their friends and their family and the lovers, they do this torture instead. Because, of course, we need to exercise our bodies. You know, and he asked this question about health. And you can ask a district nurse or a surgeon, what is this foundation of physical and mental health? And you'll almost always get the same answer. It's fresh air, exercise, meet people. Fresh air, because even if you're in the middle of New York, the air outside is always better than the air inside. We're not made to sit on sofas or in office chairs. We're made to move hunter-gatherers, so moving is better than sitting still, and it's always better for us to be with other people than to be alone. So really basic things. And then we ask, do we make environments which encourage us to be outside, which encourage us to walk, to invite us to walk? You know, this is in Sofia, Bulgaria. What an insult to my sensitive little 5 kilometers an hour body when this kind of thing comes in the middle of the footpath. You know, or so many environments where the engineering, where the turning radii, where the signage, everything then is all about cars and speed and 60 kilometers an hour and not about me being a slow little sensitive body. And it's only when you get to somewhere like Venice and talking about, you know, expensive experiences, the most expensive pizza you can ever have. But why go to Venice? Crumbly old buildings that the Italians can't take care of, stinky old canals. But why is it fantastic to go to Venice? Because it's a totally sensual experience. Intimate, narrow little streets where you get physically close, smell the perfume, you hear the languages, you can hear the water lapping. All these fantastic, rich experiences, which makes it a joy to be a human being. And because we're using all of our senses, our brains say, yeah, this is good. And we get happy, although we're paying through the nose to be there. And the places we go on holiday are often like that, offering great sensual experiences. So with that, I invite you to come and see Copenhagen, where the office has been working for over 40 years. Jan has been studying what's been going on. I'm sorry, these are really washed out slides. But just basically, it's about getting to understand the city, studying it, collecting both quantitative and qualitative data, so that when we make a decision, it's based on facts and not just kind of opinions. And Copenhagen, until the early 60s, was a totally car-dominated place, not what it's famous for today. But in the 1962, in November 62, so it was just before Christmas, 50 years ago, there was this crazy idea to make a pedestrian street. And everybody knew it could never work because the climate in Denmark is terrible. It's cold and wet. It's a Lutheran country. They're not Latinos. There was no culture. Everybody knew it wouldn't work. You know, so that, and the shopkeepers knew they'd go bankrupt if the car, you know, cars couldn't park outside the shops. And of course, what happened was, it was great. even in the winter, people came. You could let the kids run. The ambient noise level was lower. You could have a conversation. You could smell the sausages, I suppose, in Copenhagen. You could smell the coffee. You could experience the city just like, well, almost like being in Venice. And you could give this really great experience of being in the city and, you know, at capacity, 80,000 people a day. And, you know, and the shopkeepers very quickly understood that, hang on, this is really, really good. Now you can go to almost any village in Denmark and they have a pedestrian street. And that's because the shopkeepers have demanded it. Otherwise, they'd say they'd go bankrupt. You know, the weather doesn't seem to affect things. People still come out. Nyhavn, which is the kind of the postcard image of Copenhagen, the harbor, used to have 60 parking spaces. And very controversially, there was an idea during the summer season to take away parking. 60 parking spaces. You can imagine the local newspapers making a fuss. But if you count, on a normal day, there's about 600 parking spaces for people. On a summer's evening, 1,200 parking spaces for people. Who buys more ice creams? Who buys more beers? And the fact that you've got a number is great for journalists to pick up on, to start talking about these changes. And what I think is great about a space like Nyhavn is you've got the posh umbrellas, where all the tourists and the Swedes have their white wine. And then along the edge of the water, local citizens come with their six-pack and sit on the edge, and they share the same space. So the same space, different social groups, enjoying the same summer evening sun. And there's a whole thing about the climate, to enjoy the climate. And we have to work really hard. There's a joke in Scandinavia that if you oversleep, you'll miss the summer. You have to make the most of it. But what we've discovered was by doing these nice things on sunny days, that you can actually extend the season. And when this is real fact here, because if you want to put your tables and chairs on the footpath, you have to pay a fee in Copenhagen to the city. And so that means we've got very accurate information about how many tables and chairs there are on the street month by month. And the season, the summer season, which 25 years ago was basically July, has year by year got longer and longer as the market has recognized that there's a demand for this. Actually, even when the sun's not shining, it's nice to be outside in the fresh air watching people. And with a blanket, a big beer, or a glass of hot wine, you know, you can enjoy being outside. And the season now starts in March and ends sometime around Christmas. You know, so the season can get longer. And basically what we've learned from Copenhagen is that people stay longer and longer. Every square meter of improved public space is used. So if you compare with the 60s, there are four times more people spending time in Copenhagen's central city than before. So basically, make good space, people will use it. And people spend time in the city and spend money in the city, so it's good for business too. Same thing for riding your bike. And, you know, Copenhagen has now become famous for cycling. And it's all about making good conditions. The most important picture I can show you is this one, with Granny is riding her bike. 8-year-old kids riding their bike, mum, little baby behind, and you've got to convince the mum. If the mum is not convinced it's safe, nobody will bike. And you know, they can talk about, you know, the pure lines of Scandinavian design, the simple designs. There's no simpler design than the design of the Danish bike lane. And basically, it's about one line. It's the curb, or maybe two lines. So you've got the pavement, the footpath, a curb, the bike track, the parked cars in the driving lane, always that system. Instinctively, you always cycle in the same direction as traffic, so it's never two-way. So you eliminate all the dangerous collisions. So if you have an accident, it's kind of like break your arm. If you have a head-on collision, that's when you have a fatal accident. So there's no head-on traffic in the Copenhagen system. And a very relaxed way of cycling. And I said this afternoon, one of the nicest aspects of living in Scandinavia is that men don't wear Lycra. You know, which is, you know, such a huge relief, because we have this very relaxed way of cycling around the city, you know, very easygoing. You know, we respect pedestrians and cyclists. You see on the side street, the pavement continues, the bike lane continues, and cars that come from the side have to drive over the pavement as a guest. And this is a simple gesture saying that pedestrians and cyclists are important. And lots of little cute details. We have little baby traffic lights for the cyclists, and that seems really cute and nice. But you can see it's red on the big light, green on the small one. And it was negotiated with the traffic engineers are the most respected people in any city. Basically, they decide everything. We managed to negotiate a six-second starter so that when the lights change, there'd always be a six-second start for bikes. Now, 6 seconds sounds like nothing, really, 6 seconds. But if you imagine 8:30, rush hour traffic, you're stuck there, red light, and then 6 seconds in rush hour traffic when the bikes are whizzing past you, loser, kind of, you know, it is really a huge difference. And actually, it's a win-win because actually for the, well, if you think of it, this is right-hand drive traffic. So for the right-hand turns, you get all the bikes out of the way, so actually it's quite efficient as well. So a win-win thing, but it speeds up traffic, makes you feel good. There is no more conservative group in the city than taxi drivers. They will tell you how crazy the mayor is with their mad hippie communist policies. Crazy idea that every taxi had to take two bikes. The taxi drivers were furious. Stupid idea, 200 euros for a rack that those hippie communist cyclists will never use. What they discovered was people with bikes don't have cars. People with bikes go to parties, they get tired, it rains, they get drunk, they take taxis home. They discovered, the taxi driver discovered that cyclists were great customers. People with cars, the private cars, don't need taxis. So there's a huge shift where the taxi drivers, rather than seeing themselves as being part of cars and the cars are our buddies, we can buy petrol together, you know, they suddenly realize, well, actually, no, I'm a taxi driver. I'm part of a sustainable transportation system in the city, and I'd like to see more bike lanes because there's more customers for me. Bring your bike on the local trains, big flexible spaces so you can get in wheelchairs and strollers and bikes. Even on the new metro, there's a space where you can take your bike on the metro for free, which is good because you can like cycle to the metro station, take your bike for the long distance, then cycle when you get there. So it's a really good continuous journey. And there's a whole thing about this bike thing. It's not just about the hardware of bike lanes and little traffic lights. You know, I've talked about the hardware, but it's a software thing too. It's how do you create a culture of cycling? You have to teach kids in school. You have lessons in the playground, and the police take the Danish children out onto the street for live cycling lessons. You know, you have campaigns for immigrant women that didn't learn to ride bikes as a child, learning to ride a bike. And, you know, this woman in the middle, she'll never get a car. She'll never get a driving license. But if you give her the chance to ride a bike, she can visit her friends and her relations from other parts of town. She may get a job. So small things, big difference. So software, this is one about the blind angles and trucks, campaigning to promote better cycling. Like I said, you know, we don't need to change clothes to ride our bikes. Everybody can ride a bike, you know, and even the important men working offices can ride bikes. Families can ride bikes. Everybody bikes. And amazingly, 38% cycle every day in Copenhagen. You know, and this is, you know, a cold, rainy, windy country. It's a rich country. You know, they're not forced to. You know, this is my hairdresser. He cycles too. So why do they cycle in Copenhagen? And we've got really great information because we're obsessed with it. We're total nerds about facts. Do they cycle because they care about the environment? They're Scandinavians, of course. They love the environment. Do Copenhageners cycle because of the environment? 1% say they cycle because they care about the environment. Do they do it to save money? Because it's cheap, because, you know, thrifty Scandinavians. Only 6%. Is it for exercise? Is it for my body? Yeah, this is getting to almost 20%. So it's much more, is it good for me? Then it becomes like, you know, really an attractive option. Or could it just be because it's convenient and fast? More than 60% bike because it's convenient. So it's not about selling this as a commandment. It's about making this a really attractive proposition and invitation. You know, and even in the winter, people still cycle because it's convenient. Nobody's being forced to do this. You know, and this is Mary Donaldson's husband. You've maybe heard of him. He's a little bit famous in Denmark. That's their son cycling to daycare. And even the Louis Vuitton shop in Copenhagen has a bike in the window. So it's kind of, you know, and like we make these invitations to walk because everybody is a pedestrian sometimes. You know, we all kind of, when you get out of your car, you get off the bus, everybody's a pedestrian sometime. We can make invitations to cycle, to use public transportation, but maybe most important, make invitations to public space, because that's kind of like the glue that holds it all together, the in-between spaces where you wait for the bus when you arrive, and you put all of those things together and you can get really great spaces for people. Other places, can you take this invitation to other places? This is a city in Australia you might have heard of. I wasn't sure if I could use the M word when I was in Sydney. But we've been practicing our work there, you know, in anticipation of maybe doing some nice things in Sydney. Starting with reports and studies, they introduced Copenhagen, so this is on the Melbourne City website, Copenhagen-style bike lanes being introduced. And so this is a kind of an interpretation of the Copenhagen model. And obviously, we're kind of British Empire, so it's kind of on the left here. You can see we've got a much bigger, kind of higher curb. I don't know if that's something kind of like some kind of Crocodile Dundee driving technique you have here. Wider separation, and also it's you can see it's kind of divided up into bits. That's to do with the rainwater, so they didn't need to build a new drainage system. So we never like impose something directly from Copenhagen. It's more about taking an idea and reinterpreting it for the local situation. And lots of good stuff going on, and just simple things like improving the width of the pavement, the quality of the environment as you walk down the street to make an attractive city. And just a really basic thing, and I talked earlier, it's so cheap to plant trees. And like these kind of before and after images with trees, what a difference. You know, and like it's really cheap to plant trees, you know, and you get the sense of the, you know, the seasons, the sensual experience, protection from the heat of the sun, protection from the wind, from the turbulence from tall buildings, same daggy architecture, but what a difference to the streets, and what a difference to property values when there are street trees. And of course, what Melbourne's really famous for is these back streets, these little laneways where the dumpsters, the air conditioning was, that they have become the local version of Venice. Those small, intimate spaces where you can smell the coffee, move around. You know, and if you live in Australia, it's quite hard. You can't just go to Venice for the weekend. But if we can create these kind of human-scale places, they become a really an attractive option for part of our everyday lives. And for me, one of my real favorites is the flower kiosks. So rather than having a police car parked outside the city halls, they have a 24-hour flower kiosk, which is changes the atmosphere of the place. It's a sensual experience, of course, flowers, but it's policing the place in a much more gentle way. There are laneways in Sydney too, just waiting to be civilized. And this invitation to change, can you take it anywhere? Could we take it to New York? You know, you get to Times Square, which you imagine is gonna be like the most famous square in the world, and you get there, and this is it. This is the most famous square in the world, and you know, and we are just getting our measuring tapes out. 90% of Times Square was road surface. You know, it's for cars, and then if you count the people, 90% of the people passing through Times Square were pedestrians. So, 90% of the people get 10% of the space, and any journalist, any politician can do something with that. It's a really good starting point for at least a debate. We can at least talk about this. You know, and we go there, we watch, we observe, we find out what's going on. Really obviously, we knew the sidewalks in New York were really crowded, there wasn't enough space. We asked the question, could we maybe widen the sidewalks? And the traffic engineer said, no way, just don't touch the traffic. Because in any city, they had really good, accurate information about traffic flow. And here we've got 56,000 vehicle users, that includes people on buses, using Flushing Main Street every day. You know, and we went to council meetings and say, like, Mr. Mayor, 56,000 voters, don't touch that. Nobody had measured pedestrian flow at all. They had no idea about pedestrian movement. 46,000 on the left side, west side, East 51. 100,000 voters use Flushing Main Street every day. And suddenly this became very intriguing for the politicians, 100,000 voters. This wasn't about environment, this was about votes. In the same way, in the demographic of New York City, 30% of the population of New York City is seniors, that's people over 65, or children, that's under 14. 30%. In any public space, any street, park, or square we looked at, we only ever got 10%. So 30% had become 10%. And of course, who lets their kids out in New York City? Who lets their granny go out and cross the street in New York City? Now, the children don't vote, but the parents vote. Old people vote quite aggressively. So again, for Mayor Bloomberg, this is quite intriguing. Could there be votes to be gained by actually improving the life for more people? And of course, it was really obvious to us, you know, Manhattan was made to walk and it was flat, made to walk and bike. And we could show all these kind of strategies about how you might make Broadway. The idea was, I think Mayor Bloomberg said, could you make Broadway the Champs-Élysées of New York? But we can show all these diagrams, but it doesn't really mean anything. It becomes very abstract. So we had to make events. So back in 2007, we had a series of events on Saturdays in August called Summer Streets. We closed Fifth Avenue to traffic and gave people a taste of what it could be like. For the people who hadn't traveled to Europe, who hadn't been to Copenhagen, what could it be like? And it was about creating the water cooler moment. You know, when you stand there like on Friends, you know, Monday in the office, were you in the city on Saturday? It was amazing. Our kids biked on Fifth Avenue. We heard birds singing. You know, it was incredible. You gave people a taste of what it could be like. And because they had to move fast, and a big problem for politicians, for mayors, is if you do a project, you know, it takes environmental impact study, takes 6 years, planning permission takes 7, 8 years. What is the point of starting a project when it will be the next mayor who cuts the ribbon? So I mean, there was a really strong emphasis to do something fast. So Department of Transportation, amazing, strong group. Jeanette Sajid-Khan, amazing commissioner for transportation, using their own staff and an incredibly low budget, started changing the city with paint. So no planning permission. It was just do it. Let's just go out and paint public space. And basically overnight doing this. So before and after and down at ground level. And you can do this in 40 hours. Is paint public space, paint bike lanes. It's a pilot project. It's the only experiment. It was cheap. If it doesn't work, we'll take it away. And along Broadway, creating these new spaces with paint before and after. And you wonder, where were the people before? I was kind of, and just bit by bit, taking out these little difficult triangular bits of Broadway, Times Square before and after, and just with paint. And what an amazing difference. And you can see the little traffic islands, you know, before this, these new surfaces. And the amazing thing was, I mean, lots of people in New York were against this project. I mean, like, it was a strange European concept, painting public space, street furniture, what's that about? But the amazing thing was, no matter what your cultural background is, what your social economic group is, whether you've traveled to Europe or not, everybody knows how to sit down. Everybody knows how, and I'm like, wow, I'm sitting in a public space, you know, I'm drinking coffee. Anybody can do this. And instinctively, all of us can do this. And we had this whole new life emerging in New York of people discovering there was a different way to live in a city, to spend time in a city. And just the fact, and this is really important in a country with very big economic and social differences, that in the same space, people who are extremely different can coexist. This is really important in terms of creating a healthy democratic society. Now, the money starts to smell there's stuff going on. So our good friends at Marimekko, Finnish designers, you know, asked if they could very discreetly perhaps sponsor in a very nice way, just in the background, you know, to be part of this. Because everywhere we, you know, we create these good public spaces. Rents went up, shops started doing better, there was investment in buildings, real estate, people got interested. Marimekko opened their new flagship store on Broadway to be next to one of these public spaces. And it's all about making a more attractive city, more accessible, opportunities to meet, but most of all, it's about everyday life. And I think, and I guess there's any sort of message for Sydney. Sydney is such a great party city, an event city. You know, you've got the Opera House, you've got film festivals, you've got Vivid. But if you can make a better every day, like a better way to crossing the street, a better way to spend time, you really make a difference. And for me, the most touching moment of the project was back in October, I was back in New York, and I met a family who cycled to baseball practice. And they said, oh yeah, we used to have like an SUV, and now we cycle. And those children are gonna grow up to be different people because of this experience. They will experience the world in a different way because they're cycling, they're in the same airspace as other people. And because we kind of like are obsessed with data, it's very useful to have before and after statistics. You know, it's very helpful for the politicians to justify what they're doing. So we're collecting all of this data all this time to justify what we're doing. And now we have a situation where we have this pilot project, 5 years old now, beginning to look a bit scruffy. Do you want to go back? You know, it's just, we can take it away again. But now the culture is there, that New Yorkers get this and see the value of this. And now the culture is there that you can spend some millions of city dollars to have a nice granite surface, maybe high-end furniture, a bit more New York style. But it's about a cultural change, not just a hardware. And as Frank Sinatra says, if you can make it there, you can make it anywhere, up to you. And I guess this thing was transform your city, which was kind of the starting theme for this. And I guess at Gale, we were very interested in working together. We're a very small office, we're about 30 people. We've got active projects on all five continents just now. And the only way it works is we work in teams. We find really great people we can work with and work in different places around the world. And it's like working together. And I guess one of the final limitations is just about participating, being part of change. A really low-key one was a small village called Skävlinge in Sweden, where the meat packing factory closed down. At the first public meeting, and they wanted to build some new apartments and, you know, do a kind of urban thing, and we had the idea that, you know, we should have some workshops to explain to the population about this process of change. At the first meeting, people were coming and like asking for jobs, like, you know, saying, like, you know, I'm a butcher, I've got 20 years experience. People thought that we were going to reopen this meat processing factory. So we had to take this village on this kind of journey about change, how we could rebuild the site, do something which would be beneficial to everyone. It was at all level. We had to get the city planner, the village, or well, the planner, which is the word for the region, who had kind of like almost spent no time on site on her bike, and actually visiting the site and going and looking at every detail. This is what it's like. And one of the things was that, oh, we've got a really great public square. And you know, we read in the Jan Gehl book that you have to have a really nice floor. And they had this really beautiful, you know, granite floor. But was this a great space? And it's not until you actually stand there with the councillors and say, do you like this? Can we do better than this? And when you're standing there with members of the public watching you, that you have to say, yeah, okay, we could do better. You know, and get everybody round the table, planners, politicians, members of the public, and just so you know, Bad Perm, that's a politician. You can be surprised. And finding methods to work together. And one of the things I discovered very early on is people can't read plans. Most people can't read drawings. So we started working with big aerial photographs. So you could kind of read, okay, the gray is the street, and those green roundy things, that's trees, and okay, it's the park. And finding kind of simple methods so people could understand the planning process and mapping what people cared about. You know, finding, you know, putting it in post-its if there's things that are important. Because if you're an outsider as a planner, I can't possibly know what a community thinks is important. So you really have to engage everybody to map, find out what people love and care about, what they're missing, looking how they move through their places, you know, finding methods to kind of map all of that. And then finding a method, creating a kind of a roadmap. And I don't know if you know, it's kind of like when Hillary Clinton goes to the Middle East and do kind of the roadmap to peace. We kind of do roadmaps and planning so people understand, okay, we want to get there. Now we have to create a vision together. We kind of have to, you know, realize there are hindrances, there are hurdles on the way, there are potential bridges, there are events, there are funding sources we can do. And if we kind of move in a kind of maybe a slightly more wiggly way, we can maybe get to our goal. And trying to explain in a very simple kind of like analog way, now, sooner, later, how you do this process. So trying to make this kind of accessible. And maybe best of all, working with the children, because they are our best ambassadors and they totally get it. They totally understand sustainability. And there's nothing more convincing than a 10-year-old standing up and talking about bike lanes and the importance of public space, far more convincing than some Scottish architect going on and talking about it. Finally, all of this experience, 2 years ago we took with us to Christchurch after the earthquake. We had worked in Christchurch before, and you know, I think we had a program of 113 improvements to Christchurch, and I think before the earthquake they'd done about 3.5 or something. But the earthquake was this opportunity to rethink, to restart, to do something. A hugely humbling experience to stand there in like the city, which had been totally ravaged. You know, going into the red zone, seeing all the damage. You know, I mean, and every time I see an aerial photograph, yeah, I'm really shocked. There's like almost nothing left. Like last I heard, 1,500 buildings being demolished, almost the entire city centre demolished. How do you go about rebuilding? And in Christchurch, we created a kind of a process called Share an Idea, which is about letting everybody take part in a process. There was an online thing, and there was also an analog, a big event in a stadium, you know, getting people to come and just basically download everything they felt, everything they dreamed about, everything they wanted, the things they wanted back, and me preaching about walking and all this sort of stuff. And even working with the children, and that was the most fun job I've ever had, was using Lego. Basically, the kids built themselves in Lego so they could get the scale right. And then they started building the kind of environments they wanted. And this was really brilliant because the kids could imagine the kind of amazing, diverse public spaces they'd have. One little guy, I don't know if you know about the Marmite factory in Christchurch, was damaged and you know, they had to close down. One little boy built a new Marmite factory. Which you really understood this whole unemployment issue. Actually, the best project we had, and we actually were doing an interview for the film, and I don't know why, you know, it wasn't included in the film, but maybe one of the most beautiful moments was we had 2 10-year-old boys, and they built a nightclub. And so we were filming, and I said, oh, this is really great. It's a nightclub. Like, do they know what a nightclub is, you know? And I said, well, what do you do in a nightclub? And half of the nightclub was dedicated to pizza. And they talked in great detail about the pizzas you could have, and there's a pizza chef and all this stuff. And then there's a dance floor. I said, yeah, and there's a dance floor, but it's only the girls that are dancing. You know, is that like a girly thing to dance? And they just looked at me. It's Tuesday night. It's lesbian night. Children have a very good, sophisticated understanding of the world. They understand unemployment, they understand the challenges of sustainability. And even, I mean, and through, you know, you find lots of ways to capture all of that. And they really understand everything that makes a city work in all its diversity and all its complexity. But we took all of these ideas together. We got 106,000 ideas. So, I mean, and, you know, and it was kind of like every night I took this phone book of ideas to bed with me. And it was really empowering because basically, you know, we were given an amazing brief by the people. We worked with this analog method. Basically, rather than, you know, it's just print everything out big and stick it up on the wall of the local art gallery in the corridor so people can walk past it every day. And meetings, we had our meetings standing up. So people had to stand up in public, you know, and work with post-its and justify what they were doing. So it's a kind of a very open analog approach. And capturing, this is kind of a word cloud of just things people thought were important. And that was the first kind of survey we could very quickly do, just read what, I mean, like green spaces was the number one thing people said. Number two was people. Number three was cafes and restaurants, you know. So parking came in much further down the list. So we could find out what the population's priorities were. And then we started kind of like making this program. We started with 10 themes. We couldn't remember them all when it was 10. So we kind of managed to narrow it down to 5 core themes, which became the basis of the planning document. Now, planning, if you can see, this is an Excel spreadsheet. That's what planning looks like. You know, and it's not very sexy, it's not very interesting, it's hard to understand. So we had to take that Excel spreadsheet and turn it into, again, something analog, and to explain the decision-making process. Now, obviously, everybody wants the swimming pool now. Can we build that now? So, well, actually, well, maybe it's better if we build the conference center now, because if we build a conference center, there will be 10 new hotels, which will create a lot of jobs. And if we can explain these things in a very sort of simple, now, sooner, later, explaining, and actually, okay, and then, you know, we find, well, actually, we really want this swimming pool now, okay, we put it there. But you actually do this kind of very analog approach, and everybody kind of gets what's going on. Working in a very tight time frame, which actually sometimes is a really good thing, and landing in a document which tries to kind of capture the spirit of this big conversation we had, and the really great graphics people who kind of tried to capture the mood of this greener city with a stronger identity. And I'm sorry that it's so hard to, but it's kind of washed out images, but these are real quotations. So the whole document was illustrated with the genuine quotations of what the people asked for. Green city, a big theme, and showing how the existing places, the riverbank in Christchurch, which is not maybe the best of public spaces, what that could be as a response to the demand from the citizens. Same thing with Cathedral Square, huge concrete surface that nobody had ever liked, imagining what that could be as a big green space responding to the public, you know, demands. No more controversial subject than transport. New Zealanders use their cars more than Americans. It's the country in the world that use cars the most. Lots and lots of really interesting, really healthy debate. And I mean, a big thing I learned from the Christchurch experience was, although everybody had like like loved their city and like loved their way of life before, everybody could imagine a better city. Everybody could imagine a better way of life. So even people driving cars could see the logic of making maybe a different set of decisions. I mean, one of the really, I mean, was the way we brought up the subject of transport choice. Cars and parking was part of a package of accessibility to the city. We had one very special extra debate about one-way traffic, which was really, really interesting because Christchurch had progressively got more and more one-way streets, which is all about traffic flow. And you make these kind of like really long detours. And the idea was actually, if we had slower traffic with two-way streets, we'd actually get to places faster because you'd drive straight. And actually, we'd have safer traffic because you've got a different kind of driving. So it was kind of possible to do a kind of a win-win, do something which is good for the kind of pedestrian biking environment, but also good for getting around in your car. Finally, distinctive city. Like, what would it look like? I mean, that's another big subject. What will it be like? The idea of bringing down the height scale, and if you see the film, that was maybe the biggest, most controversial issue, was the height of Christchurch. Like taking away all the tall buildings and thinking rather of iconic individual buildings, thinking of a place, you know, with better microclimate, and you know, and the idea that the cathedral would be the tallest building. And you know, it could be something like this, a contemporary city, but a low-rise, walkable city. And including all of these kind of the different things like parking and public space, and trying to illustrate it in a way that could make it accessible and understandable for everybody. Now, I've been given the signal to wind up. When we finally published the project, the press was amazingly kind. And that was maybe because people recognized it. It wasn't controversial because everything in the plan, people recognized it was their plan. It wasn't like the architect's plan, it was the people's plan. And so we had a very positive reaction. But it was necessary to move fast. Like New York, we can't wait 5-10 years for it to happen. Restart, which is about just bringing in containers, you know, recreating, you know, a bit of public realm, get the shops and cafes and restaurants working again to give people a taste of what it's going to be like, you know, and come enjoy the space. And even in Christchurch, it can be nice to be a human being again. And I guess that's really what it's all about, creating these invitations in our places to make it nice to be a human being. And that first picture from Malmo in Sweden, this invitation to come and dance and just enjoy public space, different people using a space together, you know, even just, you know, the invitation to dive in. And rather than, you know, there was to be the signs like, you know, no diving, danger. Instead, what they did was they actually did some excavations. So they took away the dangerous rocks and made it possible to dive in. So finally, back to Sydney, these invitations. Like, I mean, I don't know who Christian was who loved living, or Barbara who says the magic will never end. I really invite you to enjoy your cities more, to enjoy being a human being, and I invite you to this debate. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David.